Corn Cob Piper coming at you. It is a Sunday afternoon. Hope everybody out there has a great weekend. I just want to start out on this video by letting everybody know that's on here that the title up above is not any kind of a clickbait or anything like that. This is a legit video. I just wanted to get on here as soon as possible, let everybody know what's going on, because I know you haven't seen me in a while, and I don't even know what the title is going to be that I put up there yet, but I know the reasoning for doing this video. So, at any rate, as of March 1st, 2018, the Corn Cob Piper is a former pipe smoker. I will be smoking pipe no more. I will be reviewing tobaccos no more, obviously, because I won't be smoking a pipe. So, in essence, this is really going to be pretty much an end to my channel. So, I wanted to, first off, thank everybody out there. I think I'm almost up to 800 subs, which is crazy. When I first got into this, I thought it would be super cool if I could get up to 100 subs at some point and do a giveaway. And, my channel's just grown quite a bit from then. And I do really appreciate all the support that everybody out there in the YTPC has showed me. This is one of the, most awesome communities in the world, in my opinion. But the reality of the situation is that I got some health issues going on. And because of those health issues, basically I cannot smoke anything anymore. So pipes, cigarettes, cigars, nothing. So there will be no more smoke ever going into my mouth, lungs, whatever. And I'll let you guys know what happened. So let me also preface this by saying this is not a video. Also, if you're not a subscriber to my channel and you don't know me, this is not a video to give you, reasons not to smoke a pipe. If there was any way that I could still do it, I would still be a pipe smoker. I loved it. I love being part of this community. Just can't do it anymore. So, turns out that I've had a hereditary blood clot disorder for probably quite a while, my whole life maybe, at least since I was probably a teenager. And what that means is basically my body, for whatever reason, the blood clots in my veins for, when I get bumps and stuff, which happens to other people that don't have the disorder. But what happens in the other people is your body basically just eats the clot before it does anything. With mine, the clot stays, and I had several in my body. I still do, and some of them were probably sitting around for years. And on last Thursday, March the 1st, I was out of break for lunch, passed out in the driveway, bashed up my elbow there. It's been a couple of weeks, but you can still see some of the damage I did there probably. Bashed up my face here pretty good. When I came to on the ground, I could not move my left arm or my left leg. And my camera's about to die, so I gotta change the battery. So I'm gonna leave you with a cliffhanger for just a second, and I'll be right back. Okay, sorry about that. So I'm back, got a brand new battery in there. So at any rate, I'm at work, I fall, I passed out. I come to, I can't move my left arm, my left leg. I'm face down in the driveway at work, on the concrete, and I can't get myself flipped over because obviously I can't move half of my body, and somehow I was able to just, muster up the strength to actually just slide myself and flip myself over, able to get my cell phone out of my pocket, and I called one of my coworkers, letting them know what was going on. They came out, picked me up off the ground, put me in an office chair, wheeled me inside the building. I had a water. At this point, some of the feeling in my arm and my leg were starting to come back, but it was not moving the way that I was telling it to, which was pretty freaky. I had no visual or mental problems at the time. It was just really the left side of my body was just not working. So, anyway, they take me inside, give me some water. One of the other guys pulls his car back around front. They wheel me out on the chair, put me into the car, and they take me to the hospital, which is about, maybe a 10-minute drive from where I work. It wasn't too long. And there's a messed up thing, too, that it still makes me sick when I think about it, and I can't believe it. So when I'm laying there on the concrete, right, face down, trying to flip myself over, right, this is middle afternoon, 1 o'clock, so people, and I work in an office complex, and there's, I think, six pretty decent-sized buildings there, so the parking lot's pretty good size. So when I take my break, I go out, there's a pond at the end of my work parking lot, and I go and I just hang out by the pond, get some fresh air for a few minutes. And then I go back in. So it was when I was headed back in that I actually passed out. But as I'm laying there, and I'm laying in a pretty narrow strip of the driveway at work, not one, not two, but three cars drove within a couple feet of me because I could see their tires, but I wasn't able to, because of the way I was laying, I wasn't able to lift my head up and see who it was. But I did see everybody's tires. So three cars drove within a couple feet of me coming around this turn. Not a single one rolled down their window. Not a single one asked if I was doing okay. And I was struggling at the time. I was giving it my all to try to flip over so I could get up. And had one of them just rolled down their window and said, "Hey, buddy, you doing okay?" I could have just told them no. They could have called 911 and been on their way. I know we live in a world which sucks now, that where everybody's distrustful of each other. But to not take the time to roll down your window and check on somebody that obviously you could see is struggling. And mind you, it's not like I do construction or anything. I work in an office. So when I go to work, I'm wearing dress slacks, dress shirt, hair's done. You know, so it's not like I'm looking like some homeless guy. Because I was actually, in fact, laying out by the area in the driveway where the corral is for our two garbage dumpsters. So a garbage dumpster and then a cardboard recycling thing. So I was actually laying in front of that. But still, I mean, come on, people. You just rolled on your window. But anyway, I'm getting long-winded here, and this is probably going to be a long video anyhow because I have a lot to say. And hopefully everybody out there wants to hear it. Anyway, they get me to the hospital, take me inside. I go right to triage. From triage, they take me pretty much almost immediately to a CT scan. And by this time, because my arm and my leg at this point were completely done, I couldn't move them all, from my shoulder all the way down to all my fingertips, just numb, no movement, same with my left leg. When they were doing my triage, they had me close my eyes, and I guess they were touching my left leg, and I couldn't feel a lot of it. Now obviously I didn't know that because my eyes were closed, but my wife by that time was there, and she's the one that told me this after the fact. So while I'm waiting out in the waiting room, basically I lose all function of my left arm, left leg. And at this point, I know what's happened to me. I've had a stroke. I mean, I know enough about it. I have a family history of strokes. So I know what happens to people when they have a stroke. And I figured it out on my own. So go back to CT scan. They take the CT scan. Obviously, it comes back positive. I had a right side ischemic stroke. The clot actually lodged in the right side of my brain somewhere around here. And no oxygen for who knows how long because I was passed out on the ground. And then it took me an additional 20 minutes to flip over so I could call somebody. But I don't actually know how long I was actually out for. My best guess is probably just a couple of minutes, because I knew I did spend quite a long time out there trying to flip myself over to get some help. So luckily, the hospital that my coworkers chose to take me to, which probably saved my life, is the hospital in my county, which is a pretty big county in Southwest Florida. Only one in the county that is a stroke center. So basically, that's what they specialize at the hospital. And they were able to administer a drug, a very powerful drug called TPA. Which is a clot buster, very, very nasty side effects, but basically when the doctor's running it down, he's telling you, oh, you know, if I give you this medicine, there's a 6% chance of this, 8% chance of this, and then he gets to a bleed out on the brain, so basically a hemorrhage in your brain that would you know, almost definitely kill you. 30% chance on that, and that scared me a little bit, but the alternative was the condition for my stroke was going to continue to deteriorate because the clot was still, it was still there, and it was still depriving my brain at that point of, you know, much needed oxygen. So I say yes to the medicine. They give it to me. At this point, I'm going for MRIs. They're taking like 26 vials of blood for me. I mean, it's getting pretty crazy at this point. And so I go, you know, they get all the testing done. You meet with all the doctors. They basically tell you, yes, you've had a stroke. We don't know what's going to happen. You know, at this point, I'm still paralyzed on my left side. They're telling me, you know, that may never come back. You may be have a left side hemisphere permanent paralysis, you know, forever, which basically puts you in a wheelchair. You know, at this point, it's pretty bad, but I'm still, you know, I'm still very thankful and thanking God that I still have my mental faculties. So when I was in the MRI after the CT scan, after they administered the clot buster, the TPA, mind you, that medicine also can only be delivered within the first 3 hours after the stroke. I was to the hospital just a little over an hour after the stroke, was administered the dose of TPA probably an hour and a half after the stroke. So I was well inside that safety zone. And that, in essence, probably saved my life. It definitely saved me from being a paralyzed person for the rest of my life, because they got the clot out of there quickly enough where there's something called neuroplasticity, which basically is when you have brain damage, which is what a stroke is, your brain will start immediately building new pathways for things. So obviously mine was mobility and sensation on my left hand or my left side. So as soon as that clot went out, my brain went to work and it started forming other pathways to my leg and my arm. And it was because of that medicine getting that clot out there that allowed it to happen. So that night, my leg started coming back, the feeling in it, by about 2 or 3 in the morning. Mind you, this all happened. This all started 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Thursday. So now we're into early Friday morning. About 2 or 3 in the morning, I was, you know, because they were coming in every 30 minutes or 45 minutes to give me neurological checks, which is stroke protocol in the ICU. You ever have a stroke and go to the ICU, don't expect to sleep for 3 days. I'm just telling you, because I had to have been every 30 or 45 minutes they have to run these tests on you. And I understand why. You can't get angry about it. I mean, they're just doing their job and they're there to help you. So, but man, by the time I got out of the ICU after 3 days and was in my regular room, man, I slept like a baby that first night. But anyway, I'm getting off topic again. I'm rambling, I guess, because I'm for the first time ever, I'm nervous about doing a video. And also, just to let you know, I'm not looking for any kind of a pity party here. I still have, I'm able to move. Thankfully I have a job where I'm able to work from home, which I will be doing for probably at least a month. I work for an international business coaching company, and we coach people all over the world. And basically I spend my day on the phone, internet phone, talking to our clients from all over the world. It's a really neat job. I love it, and thank God they are letting me, you know, work from home, which is one of the big perks of being there, I guess. So things in that nature. I mean, life for me, other than the fact that I'm 39 years old and I had a stroke 10 days ago, or 9 days ago. I'm not sure what the date is today, the 10th or the 11th, but 9 or 10 days ago. I think 10. You know, my life's good. I got, you know, my kids are healthy and happy. I got a beautiful wife who, you know, has been really, I can't say enough about her, really just taking care of me since this happened. And, you know, I can't really say enough about having her in my life. So, basically, I started to regain the movement in my leg, and that was back all the way, pretty much 90% back, motion, sensation, by the next morning. And when I say next morning, I'm guessing probably like 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. I felt confident that if I had to stand up, and obviously they weren't letting me at that time, that I could bear the weight and everything on my left leg and be just fine. Now, at the time, the only thing that I had gained in my left arm was movement of this finger here. You can see my knuckles are kind of busted up too from the fall that I took. So anyway, I tell you what, I've never been so excited in my life, I don't think, when I was able to move this finger. I was taking video of it with my phone, sending it out to all my friends and family. Because I was so worried that, you know, I figured my leg came back, and I'm thinking, thank God, I at least I'll be able to walk. You know, if the worst outcome is I lost my left arm, I'm right-handed anyway, so you know, you get through it. But man, I was excited when I was able to move that finger, and then slowly but surely I was able to you know move a couple more fingers, and then my wrist, and then I was able to lift my arm up. However, it was very, very weak, and it was hard to do all this stuff, but I'm not a quitter. I started my physical therapy by watching YouTube videos the very next morning after this happened, and I've been working my left arm like crazy since then, because I'm still having some issues with it. So I have 100% movement, as you can see, in my left arm. You know, I can move everything fine, but I don't feel anything. So pretty much from the middle of my hand here up to my elbow is just numb. Now I can feel pressure and everything, so when I touch it, I know that I'm touching myself, and I can look away and know exactly where I'm touching myself on my arm. However, it's the same sensation, I guess, is when you go to the dentist and they numb your gums and you touch your gums or whatever, or you touch your lip, you can feel the pressure, you know you're touching there, but you can't feel anything. That's the exact sensation that I have in my arm right now. And because of that, it's weak. And I notice myself when I walk, I'm curling my fingers in, which I can't do either. So just my main focus right now is getting the strength and the coordination back in my left arm. I may never regain the sensation. And once again, I'm okay with that. You know, once I build this arm up through physical therapy, I'll be able to do any, you know, anything I can do with this arm. I just won't be able to feel it, but you know, that is what it is. So like I said, it could always have been a lot worse. So now to the reason why I won't smoke a pipe anymore. Not that I can't, I won't, and I refuse to. I will never put a pipe up to my lips again. It's not gonna happen. Because, and like I said, let me preface this by saying this is not a video about bashing pipe smoking. It was up until very recently a very, very strong passion of mine. I love doing it, but I was never one of those people that believed that if you are a pipe or a cigar smoker, that it wasn't going to have health issues. It wasn't going to give you health issues. So, I do agree that it's not as bad as smoking cigarettes, but I could just as easily get tongue, mouth, throat cancer, nose cancer, whatever it may be, from smoking a pipe, a cigarette, cigar. It doesn't matter. Smoking in any form has side effects. I mean, you're pulling smoke into your mouth, and if you think that when you're smoking a pipe, even though you're not inhaling, that none of it gets down in your lungs, you're incorrect. If you're smoking a cigar and you're sitting in a smoke room and you're surrounded by other people that are in there, you're inhaling cigar smoke. So I was never under the delusion that it was, you know, a harmless thing. But smoking in any form does a few things. And this is pipe smoking, cigar smoking, cigarette smoking. It doesn't matter with any of them. They all do the same three things. They constrict your blood pressure. Or they constrict your arteries, they increase your blood pressure, and it is a natural, nicotine is a natural clotting agent, so it encourages your body to clot, which I can't have. So basically, when I was discharged from the hospital on Friday, I was given a prescription for something called Warfarin, I think, or something like that. Coumadin is the main name from it. You may have heard of it. It's a pretty powerful blood thinner. I am going to be on blood thinners now for the rest of my life, so I'll never come off of those. So it'll be a daily thing. Now they're giving me this Coumadin for right now because they have the most history with it. So it's been proven to work, to do what it needs to do, and what was I saying? It's been proven to work. And they have more case studies with it. So there might be, at some point, you know, it's got a lot of dangers. There's a lot of food and drug interactions with it. So you got to stay away from, you know, you got to change your diet, change your way of living, things of that nature to be on it. But, you know, that's a pretty small sacrifice to make to stay healthy, and a very easy one. So at any rate, smoking increases your clotting agents in your blood. It increases your blood pressure and increases your it restricts your blood vessels. All three things that are bad to have if you have a hyper blood clotting disorder such as myself. So, pretty easy decision. I mean, every doctor that I met with told me you can never smoke again. You got to stop. You smoke again, it's going to kill you. So, easy decision for me. I just, I'm going to miss it. I'm going to miss it definitely a lot. But it's been, 10 days and definitely a lot easier quitting the pipe. Quitting smoking a pipe than it was when I ever tried to quit cigarettes in the past. I'm not really struggling with it. Maybe it has to do something with I know that I need to quit to keep myself healthy and alive. But I'm not struggling with withdrawal or anything like that. I'm doing just fine. What I do miss is I watch matches live on Friday I didn't watch him live because he was live from work, I think, when I watched him. So I watched one of his videos anyhow, and that was used to be, that's one of my favorite things to do was at night sometimes get out my 673 KS, the Friday 7LE, and watch one of Max's videos and just go ahead and smoke a pipe and listen to him tell one of his great stories or watch one of his live chats or whatever it might be. At that point I decided that it's probably going to be a good idea for me probably to make an exit from the YTPC. And that's not any kind of shot at anybody out there. I would like to stay, but the reason that I need to move on is just because, by watching those videos, it just makes me miss smoking a pipe all that much more. And I'm not saying I may not come back in the future and start watching, become a lurker again or whatever. I'm not going to be uploading any more content to my channel, obviously, because the main thing I did on my channel was review pipe tobaccos, and I can no longer be doing that anymore. But I have some ideas up my sleeves of maybe a new channel that I'll be starting, obviously a different topic down the road, and I'll keep everybody apprised of that, because I have made a lot of great friends through the YTPC, and I'm definitely going to stay in communication through Facebook. I'm friends with a lot of you, and I know tons of you have added me on Instagram too. And now that I'm going to be working from home and not having that extra commute to and from, maybe I'll do some research and finally figure out how to do Instagram so I could touch base with a lot more of you, because it seems like a lot more people in the YTPC are involved with Instagram than they are Facebook. So definitely gonna stick around in that way, but there'll be no more content. I am gonna make a few more videos because I'm selling everything that I have. So my pipes, my tobacco, and I have a lot of bulk tobacco. So I'll go through it. I'll probably do a series of videos because it's just too much stuff I have to try to obviously offer it for sale in just one video. But obviously I'm not going to sell an ounce of a bulk tobacco. Like, probably what I'll do here is, let's say, this is how I store my bulk tobacco, or how I did store it. So when I pick up tobaccos, I have about five or six of these things. This one is labeled Virginia. So basically, this is plastic, it is not glass, but these tobaccos go inside of this container and they stay in their plastic bag. And I know it's not as good as glass, but these, keeps the moisture level. I've never had any problems with it, nice and fine in there. I think the basically doubling up the plastic with having the bag and the outside just doesn't let any of the air in to dry it out. I have not experienced, and I know this is mentioned by some people also, I have not experienced any of the taste from the plastic leaching into any of the tobacco. So in my opinion, that is more of a myth or an urban legend in regards to pipe smoking. I've been doing this system for a couple years. Some of these tobaccos that I pull out of there have been sitting in this plastic, double plastic, mind you, for 2 years, and it still tastes just as great. Moisture level's good. No plastic taste or anything like that to it. And this is my aromatic. So basically what I'll probably try to do with these bulk ones is sell by the container. So this one's probably, it's probably got 2.5 pounds in there. Aromatic, if I had to guess, is probably maybe 1.5 pounds. And I have like 7 or 8 of those full. So, you know, we'll come up with a good price. Maybe we'll do a silent auction. I don't know. I just have to figure things out. But I'll post this stuff on at least a few more videos on my channel in the weeks to come. I don't know how frequent they're going to come because my main focus right now is on my physical therapy on my left arm. But maybe doing a video where I'm showing off a bunch of bags and lifting, maybe that is a good idea. So maybe they will come soon, just cause it'll help me rehab the arm too. Basically I wanted to, you know, make this stuff available to everybody on the YTPC, to my friends out there first before I went the route of trying to put stuff on eBay. Now I have a lot of pipes as well. The corn cobs I'll probably sell, you know, as lots. You know, you buy 7 or 8, you get this price or whatever. I still got to figure things out. I just want to try to get this tobacco and pipes to people that I know that are going to use them and enjoy them. And when you sell on eBay, you really don't know where that stuff's going. And there's a few pipes that I have that I'm really sentimental about. And I would want to know where they were going. So it's almost like if you had to, like, you know, you're moving and you had to give up the family pet or something. You wouldn't just put an ad in the paper and let the first person come take your family pet away. You would try to find a friend first that would want the animal. And that's how I feel about the pipes. So not gonna let them go super easy. And like I said, anything that I don't sell, anything doesn't sell through the YTPC. And I'm not doing this video again for a pity party or a way for me to make money. This is just a way for me to give back to the community that's been so near and dear to my heart, and make sure that the stuff I got is going to a good place. So I do have lots of tins also. I have to go through them. I probably will hold off until the summertime to sell the tins. And the reason being is right now there's this huge frenzy on McClellan and Dunhill Tobacco, and I don't want to just put, you know, I have a lot of Dunhill and a lot of McClellan tobaccos in my cellar, and I don't want to just put them out there and just let people scoop them up super fast to just have them. You know, somebody wants to, you know, I'll buy all the McClellan you have or all the Dunhill you have. I don't want to do that. So what I'm going to do probably in the tins is wait till the summer and then have some kind of an auction for the Dunhill. So the Dunhill and the McClellan. Probably, like, you know, you buy a ticket for a buck or something, and then you draw. That way I can get rid of that stuff fairly, and make sure that not one person is trying to buy out those, you know, all the products that I have. Because, you know, I know, and there's a lot of people out there too that have never had the opportunity to actually try a Dunhill. You know, if it's a brand new smoker or McClellan, like there could have been somebody that, you know, smoked their first pipe last week that may never get to know what a McClellan Virginia tastes like, or, you know, say like Dunhill My Mixture 965 or Lethal Beeson. So I want to make sure that, you know, in the future that people like that will have the opportunity to get some of my tins that I have. And I won't price gouge. That's not going to happen either. You know, as long as I'm offered a fair price, I will accept it. However, don't, you know, I don't want to play around and, you know, be lowballing either. Probably when the time comes to go ahead and sell this stuff, if you offer me $5 for a 7-LE pipe, I'm not even going to respond back to that. So, you know, I'll be fair to you. I mean, there you guys all out there know me. I've been around a long time. My pricing on this is going to be super, super fair. You're going to get yourself some deals. But the reality is that I probably have, between my pipes and my tobacco, $5,000 invested, and I can't just swallow that. I gotta recoup some of it, especially because of all the doctor bills and everything that I'm gonna be incurring in the future here as well. Because there's lots of follow-ups, and I don't have insurance until end of the year, so everything right now is gonna be out of pocket. So selling this stuff is obviously gonna help me out there as well. But that's my reasoning for not smoking a pipe. and my reasoning for, you know, pretty much exiting the YTPC. Like I said, within the next couple weeks, I'll try to get these videos up, you know, of everything that I have. I'll go through my pipes, my tobacco, my accessories, stuff like that. But this is going to be, you know, pretty much, I guess, like a liquidation sale. Everything's got to go. So, if you do have any questions, or you've seen me smoke a certain pipe, or you know I like certain blends and you'd be interested in buying them, you could hit me up before I put the videos up. My email address is corncobpiping, not piper, but corncobpiping@gmail.com. Just send me an email saying, hey, you know, I like that, you know, whatever that, you know, Morgan, you know, bones pipe that you smoke, you know, I'll offer you this for it. You know, you don't have to wait till I post it on the video. That'll be perfectly fine. So I guess to end this, just another big thank you to everybody out there in the YTPC for, you know, accepting me in and making me a part of that great community. Like I said, it is with a very, very heavy heart that I am removing myself. And at some point, if it becomes easy enough, I may ease my way back in as a lurker. But also, and I guess I'll share you in a little secret here that I thought I'd probably never have to say it because I figured I'd be doing piping videos for a long time to come. But many of you know I have a very, very strong passion for gardening, vegetable gardening. So, I would like to at some point make my produce 100% sustainable in my backyard. That is my goal, and I am slowly working towards it. Next winter, I'll be adding in some new stuff as well. But my initial plan was to do a gardening channel, but I had never shot videos. I didn't know anything about YouTube, and I had just started smoking a pipe again. So I figured, you know what, let me go ahead and make a couple videos on pipe smoking just to get my feet wet, figure it out, how to edit a video, things of that nature. And then I'll stop and I'll just, you know, start my gardening channel and, you know, move on. Well, you know, let's fast forward now, I guess 14 months later, 13 months later, here I am still shooting pipe smoking videos. I have not shot not a single gardening video. My garden is pretty nice. I don't know if many of you have seen it. There's been a couple of videos I've done where I've actually showed it off. But I'll go ahead and see if I can slide some pictures in now just to show you, because my plan is now that, you know, I'm leaving the YTPC, is to do a gardening channel. And once I do, I'll make an announcement on this channel or put a link or something. But if you want to check out pictures of my garden and thinks you might, you know, if you have a passion in gardening like I do, you know, I'd very much appreciate if you'd move over to my other channel as well and continue. continue on the journey with me, because I'm not a master gardener. I'm not certified or anything like that. But I've been gardening for a very, very long time. I've gardened in lots of different climates now because I've moved so much. So I am pretty much a plethora of information about growing vegetables. I use a cross between, raised bed gardening, square foot gardening, and the Mittlaeter method. I've kind of combined the three genres together of gardening into my own thing. And I really did that because stuff down here in Florida can be extremely hard to grow. Totally different weather. The first time I planted, my entire crop failed. I've now been gardening down here for, I think, three years, and I gardened two seasons, so winter and, three seasons, so fall, winter, and spring. I do not garden in the summer here. While you can grow some stuff like peppers and things, it's just so hot out there and miserable. I just need a break. So I don't garden in the summer just to avoid the heat, other than going out there and just pulling some weeds every now and again just to make sure keeping the garden clean. So when October 1st comes, I can get it ready to plant again for the next year. So basically I garden from the 1st of October through probably the 1st of June, and then I stop. So no gardening in June, July, August, or September. So when I do start the channel up, it probably will not be until September, because that is when I will start getting everything ready to go for the October 1st planting. So, like I said, if you like gardening, I'd be super happy if you'd come along with me on that journey as well. It's hard for me to put in words how much, it's meant to me being part of this community. It really is just a great group of guys and gals. And if you're watching this video and this is your introduction to the YTPC, get your cell phone out, make yourself an introduction video, and hold on and enjoy the ride, because you never know when it's going to end. I thought I would be doing this till I was an old man, but it's just not going to happen. But I got different avenues and different things that I'm going to explore. Like I said, I'm friends with a lot of you other people out there that are in the YTPC on different social medias. So Facebook is the main one I do, because I'm not really computer savvy. I don't really know what's going on, like I said, with Instagram and stuff like that. Facebook's easy for me to navigate and use, so I stick with it. So any of you out there that, want to just send me a friend request or whatever on Facebook, it's just, you type in my name. I live in Fort Myers, Florida. Corey is my first name, Corey. Last name is Rio, Riox. And just go ahead and send me a friend request, and we can stay connected that way through Facebook. Because I really would hate to lose a lot of the connections that I have with some people out there. And it'd be cool to make some new ones now through that other social media. And also, like I said, be keep an eye out for future channel in the future. I'm not going to take this channel down, so my Corncob Piper channel will stay up. It'd be neat in 10 years to go back, I think, and watch some of these videos that I did during this past year. And, maybe things will be different then, and they'll figure out how to cure my blood clotting disorder and I could pick up the pipe again. But, we'll have to see. So I'm not out of the woods also. And once again, I'm not asking for a pity party. I'm not out of the woods by any nature from this stroke. My chance of having another stroke or having a stroke now is 50% higher than anybody out there who has never had a stroke. I also, because of the blood clotting disorders, have several clots that are still in my body. The plan is that the blood thinners will make them small enough where my body at that point can just work like anybody else's and go in and get rid of the clots. So I have a pulmonary embolism in my left lung. Deep vein thrombosis in the vein in my right leg. I also have a huge clot in my carotid artery right here, and this is the one. This is the one that everybody's scared of, because if this thing goes, I'm pretty much done for. So it's almost like I'm walking around, with a loaded gun to my head. But hopefully, nothing happens. Obviously, the blood thinning medicine does its job. And what they're really looking for is to get this thing small enough to surgically remove, just to get it to not grow and just stick around long enough where it turns into scar tissue. And then they may have to put like a stent or something in there just to open the artery back up. And then the last clot is there's a vein that drains the blood from your head that runs down the middle. And I have a clot somewhere up here as well. But the only one they are really concerned about is this one. The pulmonary embolism, the one in the brain and the one in the leg are all small. All the neurologists and the hematologists are convinced that the blood thinners get rid of those in just a couple months' time. They're hoping over like a 6-month period, we can get this one small enough to, like I said, either operate or to, have it turn into scar tissue and just put in a stent. Either way, it probably would end in surgery. But that's the plan of action for now. I've also, gone ahead and changed up my diet, switched into healthy living, went out to the grocery store, spent a few $100s, switching over to, everything's all organic now, and just instead of Little Debbie's, eating salads, things of that nature, just because I want to be around for a long time. My kids are young, and they need their dad, I need them, so I'm not, plan is I am not going anywhere for a long, long time. But I just wanted to share with everybody so nobody was wondering why I disappeared or why I haven't been doing videos. I've been dreading doing this video for the last 2 days. I've been going over it in my head, not really knowing what I was going to say. I think I got through it pretty good. Anybody wants to, if you got any questions, I'm a pretty open guy. I'll explain anything more that I didn't explain in this video. I really got nothing to hide if you want to know something medical, at least what's going on with me. Once again, this is not a video to scare anybody and saying quit smoking a pipe or you're going to have a stroke. I don't believe that. I believe you can continue to smoking a pipe, probably have no issues for the rest of your life, and die of natural causes from old age. So this is just something personally that I need to do for myself, and I'm sure that everybody out there watching understands. I mean, it was a super easy decision for me. Either you smoke a pipe or you die. I mean, it's a pretty easy one to answer for yourself. So I'm going to miss it. I'm going to miss everybody out there. I love each and every one of you. I really do. I feel like a lot of you out there are family members, great friends. I've met so many new people, and I couldn't have really asked for anything better over the last year. Sean, Ghost Cop, if you're watching, I just got your package for my 500 sub giveaway, finally sent out to you yesterday. Because I'm no longer going to be smoking a pipe, I added some more goodies in there for you, so you really got hooked up. I included also in that box all the stuff that I have not really been smoking in 2017, but I included as well all the rest of my corncob pipe blends. So I think there was like 7 or 8 blends that I did, and those are all being sent your way as well. So I guess just stay tuned over the next, I would say probably month or so, just for some sporadic videos here and there for me. Just listing some of these pipes and tobaccos for sale. And then in the summer, I will probably do my final and farewell video, which will be going through the tins and offering them up to anybody that might want them. So, like I said, if you got any questions, need to get in touch with me, Facebook, Corey, Corey, last name Rio, Rioux, or email me at corncobpiping@gmail.com. Once again, corncobpiping, not corncobpiper, but corncobpiping@gmail.com. Thanks for watching and letting me be part of your great group. And for one of the last few times to ever be said to you, as always, you two, keep on piping. I've been around this world, yet I see no end. All shall fade to black again and again. This storm that's broken me, my own.